Hello and welcome to another episode of Call of the Week, the show where we decide what decks to call and what decks to keep. Got a very special episode for you going on this week. We will not be calling the week, but instead, we'll be watching Siaka kick butt and take some names. We're going to be taking a look at a game from the KeyForge Premier League. Of course, Siaka has been invited. He has great skill, in case you have not noticed already. So he's been playing over there. We're going to be taking a look at one of his games. Jupiter, the organizer of the league, might be dropping in on us later, mid-game. He's busy streaming another game right now. But let's go ahead and take a look at the decks. Siaka is going to be playing He Who Urgently Spawns Adaptation. This is a Worlds Collide Logo Saurian and Star Alliance deck. First thing that pops out to me here is the double E-Die. It's going to be real good for increasing key costs. Looks like the rest of Logos is focused a lot on having some efficiency. You've got your Igor, you've got Hapsis, you've got Quant, Daughter, Wild Wormhole, all help out with that efficiency there. Titan Guardian and Sanitation Engineer as well. A little bit of key cost control with the Information Exchange and Candle Unit. Saurian has six Sempora Tyrannosaurus. That is the very interesting dino card that allows you to remove all the amber from the most powerful creature and then destroy that creature. Put all that amber into your pool. I don't know what he uses it with. He's got a Pterodactyl that's going to be nice and juicy. Maybe the Theo Centurion can get a couple of amber onto him and then use it. With the Golden Spiral, you could definitely load up a creature with some more amber. I guess the Centurion can get a decent bit of amber onto him in combination with the Golden Spiral for a 6 Sempora, but if you've got your Pterodactyl out, it's not going to work. Finally, Star Alliance with the Quixel Stone. Now this is definitely going to be important here. Quixel Stone not allowing you to play any creatures if you have more creatures than your opponent. Quite a few upgrades in Star Alliance here. That's going to work out well with the Quixel Stone. I'm not sure how well it helps him in the other houses. It seems like he has quite a few creatures, so not sure how that's going to work out. Like I said, Siaka is an excellent KeyForge player. I'm sure he knows this deck well and knows what he's trying to do with the Quixel Stone there. So we'll see what happens. Siaka's opponent today will be Drazkor. Drazkor will be playing Elbauthin Gurubuk Huber. Not sure if that's an English deck. None of those look like words that I know. Guru, I suppose. Lots of doubles and even a triple daughter in Logos here. Wow, that is really neat. Got some efficiency, quite a bit of efficiency. Double Tao Tao Vapors, double Interdimensional Graph, so Siaka's going to have to look out for going too high in his amber count. A Data Forge to be able to close out with the Interdimensional Graphs. The Tao Tao Vapors going to be, Edai going to be helping out to make that Data Forge viable. Shadows. Not a ton of stealing in the shadows. You got Trust No One, which could be interesting with the Quixel Stone. It actually looks like this may be a bit of a tough matchup for Siaka. I think he actually has more creatures than Drazkor. Drazkor's creature count coming in at 18, Siaka's coming in at 21, so pretty close, but still. Siaka actually has more creatures. Ronnie providing a bit of steel for Drazkor there as well. Hit and Run, going to be able to pick up that Ronnie again. Yangtze Gang one more steel, but no big scaling steel, just the interdimensional grafts. Some pretty typical untamed worlds collide over here. Nature's Call is going to be really helpful playing against the Quixel Stone. I wonder if Siaka ends up discarding the Quixel Stone here. Ghost Hawk, also really good against Quixel Stone. Gets you some extra reaping in with your few creatures that you're able to have. Mab the Mad, a little bit of extra Amber Gen there. He's got the double Pampaka, the Anga and the Jaga. So everything can be super strong and a skirmisher if he can manage to get them out. Poe's Pixies. I don't think Poe's Pixies is going to be super relevant here. Siaka does not have a ton of steel, if any, information exchange, but I think that's it. Well, this certainly promises to be an interesting game. Like I said, real high level stuff. You can see they brought some heavy hitters, both decks coming in 80 or above. At this point, once you get past 80 sass, it comes down to matchup. So it's going to be an excellent game. Let's go ahead and hop right in. Alrighty, the decks are chosen, the players are set. I'm here to observe, the hands are open. Let's get rolling. Siaka in the top corner here with He Who Urgently Spawns. Adaptation. Adaption. You can read. Drazkor. On the bottom side here. Albathan Guru Buck. Uber. Drazkor going to be taking the first turn here. Both players taking their time checking out each other's deck lists, seeing what they have got. And I suspect Drazkor is going to keep this. Look at that. Two Daughters and an Igor in the opener. Anytime you see blue in that opening hand, you're probably going to want to keep it. Siaka with the Edai and the Daughter, also showing a bit of blue himself. I imagine he might keep this, although he does have the Gallum in the opener up here, which is not what he wants, and the Six Tempora as well. Drazkor starting off with the Daughter, pulling into the interdimensional craft. Siaka going Dinos, Six Emporing the Daughter, that doesn't happen often. Dropping down the Raptor and the Gallum. Igor coming out for Drazkor, gonna get through some more cards. Drazkor's fine with that Daughter going down, he's got another one waiting for him. Picking up the Nature's Call is Drazkor. Dropping down one of those interdimensional graphs, putting out his other Daughter. Loving these half cards. Really cleans up the play space. I think makes for a much more enjoyable viewing and playing experience. Siaka going into Dinos once again. Golden Spiral coming out. He's going to Imperium up his two creatures, I would suspect. Pterodactyl coming down as well. I expect he's going to fight with the Raptor here and then use it to either unstun or to reap. What's it going to be? Yeah, he's fighting the Daughter. Oh, I see. The Gallum took away the elusive on the Daughter. The Raptor finished the Daughter off and then readied the Pterodactyl to unstun it. Imperium warding the two creatures that were already on the board there, the Gallum and the Raptor. Back to Drazkor. Drazkor going untamed. Mab the Mad coming down. Post Pixies as well. I expect we'll see a Nature's Call here, maybe to pop some wards or get Pterodactyl back in the hand. And probably play down Mavic once again. Kongafunk coming out as well. Yep, he's sending the Pterodactyl back to the hand. And he got rid of the two wards. He did not go for the extra amber off Mavic Mad, popping those wards. Yeah, that's a solid choice. That makes sense. You don't want that Gallum staying around and that raptor could also cause problems for you. And he wasn't going to go to check anyways, so. Siaka going into Logos. Look at all that blue he's got sitting there. He's ready for a Logos turn. I always like to start out with the wormhole so that in case something happens, you can kind of react to whatever happens. You don't end up wasting resources on your turn, but we'll see what Siaka does here. Titan Guardian coming down. Keep that Gallum nice and safe. Edai gonna go on the other side. Also gonna cower behind the Guardian. Daughter coming out exposed on the other side. The Entropic Swirl. Unfortunately, his opponent has nothing with two traits on it. Does he do the Entropic Swirl on his own Raptor? No. He goes for the Pose Pixies. Oh, so he can play Information Exchange. He wormholes into Information Exchange. That was very... You know, I would say lucky, but Siaka is a really skilled player, and I know that he knows this deck well, so that might have actually been something he was thinking through there. Drascor going Shadows. He's got a bunch in his hand there. I expect to see a mug on the Raptor, but maybe he will take something else. Stealing one with Trust No One. Mac the Knife. Love Mac the Knife. Gives you lots of options. You can just creep on any turn or use the ability. Ronnie coming down, stealing another. Putting Drascor up to 4. And now 5. Putting the Pestering Blow onto the Edai so that Edai cannot creep. He's enraged. And then Mug is going onto the Raptor. Putting Drascor up to 7 and check with the one card in the archive from Siaka. Siaka going Star Alliance. I don't think he has a way to stop the check here. Stealth mode. Not going to be too consequential for Drascor here. He only has 2 actions in the hand, so unfortunate timing for Siaka. Medic going to ward the daughter. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. I was expecting an extra layer of protection from Edai, but daughter, you want to keep that efficiency going. That helps you out a lot. Putting the Plasm Nozzle and Ingram's Blaster onto the Titan Guardian. Gonna be able to wipe up some of these little creatures on Drascor's board if Drascor gives him the chance, now that he's got that Plasma Nozzle on the Titan Guardian and Ingram's Blaster. He's gonna really be able to get some work done on that board. Drascor forging the first key for 7. Siaka is just behind check with 5. Giving Drascor another turn, he does not need to worry about keeping Siaka off check. What's he going to do here? Remember, stealth mode is in play, so he cannot play the Data Forge for that Amber. He cannot play Unnatural Selection, which he probably wants to right now, given the Siaka's board is starting to grow past his. I guess it only has 1 more creature. But I think his creatures are probably more useful in general. He is going untamed. I wonder if he chucks the unnatural selection or if he just holds on to it. He does not have a whole lot of other board control in this deck, so he might hold on to it here. I'm not sure. Taking his time. Thinking things through. I'm wondering what he is thinking about. Seems like a less than ideal situation here because where his cards are positioned. Mac the Knife is going to be useful anyway, so he doesn't really get the benefit from the Ghost Hawk, because he can't use it on two creatures that he couldn't already use. Does that make sense? Congafant is destroying itself with a Reap. Mab the Mad is shuffling into the deck. Yeah, I bet he really wishes he could play that Unnatural Selection right now. I'm really curious what he is thinking through here. If he's trying to decide whether to use Mac the Knife to pop the ward. There he goes. Pops the ward on the daughter. And then he's going to go ahead and reap with either the Ronnie or the Igor. Goes for the Igor. Yeah, I suspect he was thinking about whether he should try to get rid of the daughter or pop the ward or just reap with the Mac the Knife. Mac the Knife, very versatile card. Lots of options. Speaking of Mac the Knife, Siaka using Edai to whiff the elusive on Mac the Knife. Titan Guardian coming in to fight Mac the Knife and wipe out those neighbors. Cleaning up the board here is Siaka. Daughter's gonna reap. Igor's coming down. That Titan Guardian has a lot of, especially in a World's Collide board, it's just sweeping things up. Look at that. Look at that. Okay, oh, and he held the Unnatural Selection. So Draskor is gonna be really happy he held on to that unnatural selection given this board we see out of Siaka here. But he's not gonna, I suspect, go back into Untamed just to play the Unnatural Selection. He's got nothing else. So he's probably gonna go for Logos here. I mean, unless he wants to play one card. And I expect that Edai's gonna be able to keep him off of check. Nope. Nope. He goes for Untamed and wipes that board up. This is what happens when you commentate games between players who are have much higher skill level than you. Stuff that you don't expect happens. Letting Siaka forge so that he can wipe up the board, leaving the Raptor, Igor, and the Quant. Yeah, good choice. And now he's got a fistful of Logos to kind of jumpstart things on his next turn. Yeah, okay. I mean, that makes sense. He took care of that board. Siaka was going to be able to go basically any house and have a pretty big turn. So I guess that's the right call. Dinos for Siaka. Still going to be able to have a pretty good turn with Dinos here. He's got the Spiral to use something. He's got a Raptor that can reap. Shrix. Gonna get him a little extra amber here. Probably gonna ward the Shrix with his Legionary. Yeah, there's the Shrix coming down. Yep, Legionary's gonna pop a ward onto him there. And whoa, he's getting lots of amber on that Shrix. Look at that. He's almost in check. He's just shy of check with the extra amber sitting on top of his Shrix there. Wild. And he's got a Quadricorder, which when he plays it is really going to drive up the key costs for Draskor. I hope I'm saying that name right, Draskor. Draskor playing out the Hologramathon and an Edai. Edai gonna drive up that key cost for Siaka here. Another daughter coming down. Going back into Saurians is Siaka. I expect to see a fight out of this Spartasaur. Probably into the daughter. Yeah. And then someone's gonna take care of the Edai, I'm sure. Oh, interesting. The Jirta is taking out the Edai. Both players in very solid positions here. This is a close game. Legionary gonna clean up the daughter. Strix chugging out that amber, as Strix is wont to do. I'm curious why Siaka didn't use the raptor to fight so that he could then use another creature. Maybe he didn't want to put more amber onto his board. 6 amber sitting on Strix here, enough to forge, plus he's got another 6 in the pool. Draskor is going to have to pull something out here if he wants to keep this game going much longer. I'm not sure what he's got in his draw. He's got the Data Forge in the archive, but that's not going to do too much. Going for an untamed turn here. He's going to be able to stun something. Regrowth. Maybe bring in back a Edai? Not going to be too helpful right now. Regrowth. Is pulling back the Kongophon. Okay, so he's going to stop Siaka from reaping on his next turn, or at least slow him down. With a very beefy Kongophon, thanks to that Anga over there. Siaka using all the amber on the Strix to forge. That makes sense. Don't leave anything on the board for your opponent to pick off. And he's already in check for his final key here. So does he try to prevent Draskor from forging with his Star Alliance, or does he just race? Looks like he's going to race with his dinos. I think that's the right call. If he can just get a ton of amber here, he's in a pretty good position. The Raptor fought into Pampaka, wiping up everything else, thanks to the Spartasaur. It's a wild ability there. And he's just going to reap out with the rest of his stuff. I don't think Draskor has any response here. I'm not seeing anything that's going to let him come back from this. This is a pretty solid position from Siaka. 11 amber with 3 more on Strix. Draskor going for the shadows, pulling in the archive. Spike Trap, Chimera Eclipse. Yeah, this game is over. Yeah, Draskor missed the stealth mode, was out there. That's a bummer. That happens sometimes, and it really hurts when you miss one of those big cards. It hurts. Okay, and it looks like we're gonna have Jupiter joining for the next game here. Hello.
Hey, Brobnar. This is Brobnar. This is Brobnar 89 is joining us in the stream. We didn't like show anything yet. So, first game, give us a recap. It just got finished right when I was peeking in. So,
right.
Tell us what happened.
Perfect timing. Yeah. So it was pretty close up until the last couple of turns there. Siaka was building up a really big dino board, and he kind of just like ran away with it at the end. Draskor missed the stealth mode that came out from Siaka, and so he wasn't able to play his unnatural selection, and he had to then the next turn he had to take a whole turn just to play out unnatural selection and wipe the board. And I think after that, it was just too deep a hole for him to dig out of.
Yeah, so So the two decks that we have being played right here, I'm bringing them up on screen for other people to see, is He Who Urgently Spawns Adaptive. This is the deck that he's talking about, what Siaka is playing. Has a huge dino presence, has Spartasaur, Sixth Emperor. Doesn't have the tribute, unfortunately, but I think he makes enough amber with his creatures and the Golden Spiral to basically make that Sixth Emperor still work for him. And then he has the double ED, like for control value, lots of... you know, little engines in the Logos, probably not the fastest suite, but for Adaptive, you don't want to be like playing pure fire, especially at the level the league is at. And then in Star Alliance, you do see that it has stealth mode, double zap, quadricorder, so again, and a Quixel Stone. So the Quixel Stone being super relevant with the Spartasaur, that seems pretty gross. But on the other side, we have Huber, Elbathan Guru Buck Huber. This is a Logos suite that does drive Logos. Lots of speed, lots of archiving and stuff going on there, and a data forge. So it does have a key out. The shadows is kind of lacking. It has a Rani, but that's about like, you know, like the big highlight. It does have Hawk to help with that Quixel Stone. So I guess that's pretty good.
Yeah, there's Rani with the what's the pickup? The hit and run. But,
hit and run.
Not a ton of scaling amber control really out of shadows.
Yeah, so it's kind of like a little bit on the weaker side for a shadow side. And then you look at his untamed. His untamed is actually pretty good. It has Nature's Call, has the Pampakas, it has Inca, Opexies. It's a very unassuming untamed, but it has a lot of cool tricks, like little things that affect the game state and stuff. So interesting choices by both players. And like you said, Siaka kind of got his love on a little bit. Late in the game, and once that stealth mode was missed, it basically went awry a bit, right?
Yeah, he ran away with the dino board. It was interesting. He seemed happy to throw out the Six Empora pretty early just to take out a daughter. Looks like the second game is up here.
Are you in?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, make sure they wait for you, because I know you're recording for your stream. So why don't you plug your stream real quick, or your where you are going to be having your video.
Yeah, Siaka and I run a twice monthly YouTube channel called Call of the Week, where we kind of do a round robin of a couple of different decks, and we just try to decide which ones we want to keep and which ones we want to get rid of. And so, yeah, if you are interested, check it out. We're on YouTube. Call of the Week is the name of the show.
All right. I'm going to make sure I check it out and subscribe to it, because I
didn't
know
you.
About that.
I appreciate that. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and maybe we'll have you on for more of these during the leagues. We definitely need more commentators. So you are always welcome, to be part of this.
Oh, awesome. Thank you. I will keep that in mind. Yeah.
Are you here, Rob? Are you in the game?
Yeah, I'm watching. I'm here.
Okay. Okay. Go ahead.
So I just wanted to make sure we're doing this right here. I see open hand. So is that kosher?
It is open hands again, but oh well. I'll you know what I'll do is I'll throw up. I don't think they're in. I can see if they jump in my stream chat. I don't think they are. They're not.
Okay.
As a precaution, I'll set up a quick image block for it.
Okay.
I don't like the idea.
Then
I'll trust them. Go ahead.
I was gonna say I'll try to pretend I don't know what's in their hands.
Yeah, just go ahead. We'll just go with it and see what happens.
All right. Well, Siaka's taking a mulligan. Didn't like what he saw in his opener there. And Drazkor has the first turn again, starting off with a medic warding herself. And now the players have switched decks because it's adaptive.
There, now I can make this into a hand screen. I don't know how this is going to work well, but... Yeah.
Drazkor going for Logos, dropping the Titan Guardian to keep that medic safe. Now enraged medic safe. Candle unit on the other side.
Alright, we're going to do that, and we're going to duplicate it.
Oh, I see. So you're shielding the hands there.
trying to. I guess it's going to take me a minute because I'm not overly proficient at the at the engine here, but I think I can get this done.
Early spike trap from Siaka is going to take out the medic and put some damage onto the candle unit. Edai coming down along with Daughter. You want to see all that blue nice and early. It's looking good for Siaka here.
Siaka is a member of ABR, right?
You correct. Both? Yes, we are both on the ABR team.
Yeah, so ABR, I just joined their league so I can actually play competitively again. Yeah, so I'm excited for this season. I got drafted by Z.
Oh, nice.
I heard that there was a little bit of scheming going on by Z for that.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Because I have access to our team library, the United Archons team library, which gives me all my decks plus all of Clint's decks.
Oh. So
nobody else, I think, thought of that. And right. So they after he mentioned it, they basically said, okay, fine. Like, yeah, I get it, but only I can use my team decks, right? Like, so I can't share this.
That's good because Z probably doesn't have enough decks of his own, right?
Right. Our deck collection is pretty good for our team, but getting people getting people comfortable with it is a bit tricky too, right? Like, I think familiarity goes a long way in decks. So.
Oh, definitely. Right. Yeah. No, that's huge. Especially when you're not just playing straight Archon format all the time. There's a lot of different wonky formats in that league. If anyone listening is not in the ABR league, there will be another one starting probably in around 2 months or so. But it's a team format league where you play, you can share decks on your team and you can play a bunch of different, or there's a different format every week and you have a different opponent every week. It's a pretty neat league.
All right, so I got my blocks up.
All right. Just a lot of logos going on. Both sides trying to get that efficiency in early. Siaka sitting on 8 cards in the hand. Looks like he's trying to decide what to archive with his Tau Tau. And an interdimensional graph comes down for nothing here.
Draskor is sitting on an interesting set too, so... Both of these guys are positioned pretty well to spar early on. Like, I think these decks are going to kind of go at each other back and forth a little bit. And
right.
The first person to make a mistake is going to lose, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly what we saw in the last game. That one error, that one missed stealth mode just kind of threw the game.
It also tilts you a little bit as a player, right? Like, when you make a mistake like that and you catch it, like, especially, like, at the end of the game, if you go, man, I made this mistake, that means that during the game they had that in their head, and that's a bad play.
Mm-hmm. I imagine he paused for quite a while after he chose house there, and I imagine he was just cursing at himself for a while.
Yeah, Traskor is a good guy. I've been having him on my podcast lately, and again, anybody out there that wants to be on the podcast, I will bring you on the podcast and we can talk. And the idea is that we talk kind of, we're not looking to cater to the high-end Keyforge players, even though a lot of them listen and kind of give in inputs and ideas, but the idea is that we learn something every episode that new players might not have thought of, or that new players can get something and walk something out of. So everybody is welcome to be on the show if they want to be on the show and promote whatever they want to promote. So I just like to have Keyforge community, you know, discussing things. I like there to be media for us, and that's what that's all about. So,
oh, that's neat.
Keyforge Premier League weekly on Anchor, and it's all linked at our website that you guys have seen in this frame, in the welcome to the stream clip frame right there. See below, boom, 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 https://www.crazykillingmachine.co.uk. It's too, like, my brain is not working today. Not that it works on most days, but.
Well, Siaka managed to get the Ronnie off with the hit and run there. So he's sitting on 6 amber. But key costs are up for him with the Gallum here.
So.
Look at all those dinos coming out. The dino board is what did it for Siaka last game, but it's so early and we haven't seen the unnatural selection out of Siaka yet, so I would be a little wary of loading up the dinos too much. I think that natural selection is the only board fight in the deck that Siaka is playing now, which is Drazcore's deck. So that's really the only way that they can deal with the big dino board. So yeah, I'd be cautious putting too much hammer out on the board right now.
Yeah. So like Vincent, you're asking about AVR. It's not AVR, ABR. Ancient Bear Republic is what their it stands for, the acronym. And it's a league that has everybody in it. Like Joe Caruso, which is he was on stream earlier. That's X something, three numbers X, I can't remember.
Yeah, and, something like that.
And then Brobnar here, they have Blinking Line is there. There's a whole bunch of people you could reach out to that would help you. Mark H is ABR, but 100% quality people, and that's a league by the people for the people. Because everybody plays in the league, and they all have like come to fun ideas and things to do for the league. So far it's been a blast. And I'm only in week one, so like just figuring out the teams, having 9 other teammates, and everybody's kind of relying on everybody. They have a feature match which I get to play in this week. Should be interesting.
It's a really neat, unique team format because it's like a big group and you form kind of a community. This is the third one. I've played in all of them, and it's just a really fun unique format and way to play Keyforge, because you don't usually think about like playing necessarily on a team when you play Keyforge, so
yeah. So interesting stuff.
Whoa, Siaka's bursting all the way up to 12 here. That unnatural selection came down for value, getting rid of all those dinos.
Yep, and we saw that Drazcore said he made a mistake again. So there's a tip on the was a mistake there. Oops, he could have changed his house. He could have asked if that was the mistake.
Changing, I wonder, houses. Well, but that was already on Siaka's turn though. So I think maybe.
Oh yeah, maybe it was during his turn.
Maybe during his turn, yeah.
What did he do? That was a mistake, I wonder. Was it maybe putting a bunch of amber on creatures?
He did exalt Shrix there. Yeah.
I'd be curious to ask him what he thought his mistake was. I didn't pay enough attention to see it.
Yeah, it's unfortunate to see that, because like he is obviously an excellent player to be playing in this league, and it seems like maybe he hasn't had his coffee yet.
He won his first ever Vault Tour.
Oh wow.
Like he went to PAX and I guess it was technically his second event, because he played in the regular event and then he played sealed and he won the sealed event. But his first event ever, and he would one out of two wins in a Vault Tour. So
wow. Wow. Not everybody can do that, that's for sure.
Yeah, he came from a board gaming background and stuff. I've learned a lot about him. He's down here in Pennsylvania, so he's really close to me. So we've been forming a tie. He's a really cool guy. It's interesting listening to his takes. Like if you listen to the podcasts, like and stuff, like I've been letting him drive them a little bit and kind of being the backseat noob and like just letting him say things, and then I ask him questions to see how he responds to them, and he knows what he's doing. He's really good.
Okay. Yeah, that's neat. I'll have to check that out. Yeah, it's a kind of a similar with my show with Siaka. He is as you can see from his play here, he is a superior player to me, that's for sure. And we just kind of bounce ideas off each other and stuff. So
yeah, Keyforge is all about the process of discovery. So it's a good thing to see people who know how to play the game helping people learn the game. And then it's the best thing is like some of the people that I originally have helped like start playing and learning, and that listened to my earlier stuff, because I've been podcasting since day one. Like it's cool to see them, and they're probably better players than me now. So like, that makes me feel good. Like, when you could pass me, that means that, like, I'm happy that you're finding that progress, because not everybody's going to be a top level Keyforge player, right? But there's definitely, like, I like being the wall, like the gatekeeper.
Yeah, and sure.
I invite people and go, hey, get to my level, and then you can start figuring out your own stuff, right? Because I'm basics and fundamentals of the game. Like, once you understand the game, like, then you can figure out your style. Because every Keyforge event has a different style, right? Like, different way to play. So there's definitely lots of different metas.
Wow, Zap being very effective here. Going to clean up everything, pretty much.
Does he lock it down with the Quixel? I would.
Interesting. Yeah, you know, the other Siaka, the deck that Siaka is playing right now actually has more creatures. Oh, he's discarding it. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, you think at this point that would have been the right call?
I think so, because, like, I mean, like, there's, like, your deck is fit to go around it, right? Like, you have a lot of pips and stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, when you're playing a Quixel Stone with as much raw amber as you have in here, and with all the enchantments and stuff like that, I think it's good. And being up on the card count, like what is he going to do? Is he going to kill the Titan Guardian by using Spike Trap?
Right.
Like, no.
Yeah,
that would clear the board. Like, and then he's basically one for one now. And then since he didn't do it, now he's going to be able to populate the board more, and he'll be farther ahead.
Yeah,
he
Drazkor needs to slow the game down too if he wants to.
Yeah, I mean, he's down two.
Yeah.
So I don't. I think I played the Quixel there.
Yeah.
But Quixel
Stone, that
might have
been the right call.
Quixel Stone does change the way the game is played, though, and some people aren't comfortable with it. So, like,
it makes her a great adaptive deck. That's for sure.
Yeah, especially like Quadricorder right now with Quixel Stone would have been great, because then he just puts it on his creature and basically locks the game there with them needing that much more amber.
Right.
Like, there's a lot of things.
Drop it on Mac the Knife or something. Yeah.
Well, Mac would be the only thing that could really come out if he got rid of the Titan mechanic. Like, if he had killed off the Titan mechanic, he could lock it down.
Yeah. Right. That makes sense.
And then anything he plays, he could basically stone, attack, kill, like clear the board.
Right. And like, look at this turn coming from Siaka. Look at all. Oh, I mean, we don't know what's in his hand.
You could say, but he's about to drop like all his Untamed.
Yeah,
like,
he's about to have a really big turn here that he wouldn't be able to have if the stone was out.
Yeah, I get that. I did get my mailing out, so Not Tonight will be getting her Fuzzy Gruen soon, so I'm excited. She was the closest person to qualifying for a league that didn't qualify in the last event, the last qualifier. So,
oh, that's nice.
So I sent her a Fuzzy Gruen.
Warm fuzzies for you. That's nice. Uh-oh, Inka's gonna... I mean, we don't know what's in the sand.
you can say what you need.
Inka's gonna have to stun one of his own creatures here. Maybe a slight misplay by Siaka there.
Yeah. Sequencing thing.
Yeah.
The number one thing that any player makes in these games is just not sequencing properly. And I find on TCO it happens a lot more than it does in paper.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's one of the downfalls of TCO is that I can't move my cards to put them in line. Like when I play in person, I'm way cleaner because I can put my cards in position and I can go, okay, this is how I want to do it. And then once I'm ready to go, I commit to my line, right?
Right,
like
right.
Here you're kind of bouncing around or you get lazy and you just start throwing stuff. Like it's very much more common. So like when I play online and on streams and stuff like that, I hardly ever play well because I don't have the focus to do that. But if I'm playing like an ABR league, when I play my feature match, you guarantee that I'm going to play my best. Like I'm going to be locked in. I'm going to be slow reading things and
yeah,
sure I'm doing what I'm supposed to do because I don't want to let my team down. Right. So
yeah,
that kind of puts me in a different level.
I play notoriously slow on TCO for that exact same reason because it's like
I don't think you play that slow. I play with you a lot. Like I don't think you've ever played me slow.
Well,
like
it's happened before.
I get it.
That's game.
Wins 2-0 here.
Taking it down. Yeah, I think it's a rough morning for Drazkor because it looked like he was he's definitely a great player, and I think he was on stream. I hate making mistakes, he says. Yeah. That's a bummer.
So I'm asking him why he didn't play the Crystal Stones.
Yeah.
So actually, I could join him into this call too if you wanted to. Do I have you as a friend? I need to add you as a friend so I can actually conference call people.
Oh. Let me look here.
That's fine. I find that on Discord I don't have as many friends because I think friending on Discord is a weird thing. Like, it's not like intuitive to do. Because you just talk to everybody in main chats and stuff. And
it's not necessary, PMing. Yeah.
Yeah, and until you start PMing, it doesn't matter. But, like, in League, I have to get everybody to friend me so that I can make groups for people.
Oh, yeah. We can ask him what the alleged mistake was, too. I'm curious what he was thinking there.
Yeah, let's bring him in if he wants to. Let's see if I can find him. For his cooler. He wants to join us. I don't know if he's willing to talk about it, but he's a great guy to talk to, so if he wants to, he will. If he can't, he won't.
Hey.
Hey, so we have you live on stream, just so we're not blindsiding you, but we wanted to talk it out because you seem bummed a little bit, but...
Mistakes. Siaka? He just told me how to pronounce Siaka, yeah.
Siaka.
You want to bring him in, too?
I could.
He and I were just chatting, so...
Yeah, let me bring him in.
Where wanna is leave him hanging.
No, we'll add him real close.
Yeah.
How do I put him in here? Let's see, Siaka. But yeah, like, I'm curious, because, like, we don't know the second game. Like, I know in the first game they said that there was a stealth mode play, then you missed the stealth mode, and so we understand that mistake. In the second game, what was the mistake? We kind of missed it.
So in the second game, what I should have done and what I was going to do and just clicked through it too quickly was I had Spartazar on board, and I was going to exalt the raptor and fight one of my two guys. I hadn't decided which one, probably the guardian to draw the two cards into it's one of my, you know, probably the Yancey gag, maybe something else to with Spartazar blow up the whole board, and I would have had big board advantage.
Right.
Instead, I didn't exalt, and then next turn was a unnatural selection, which really set me behind.
Yeah.
And what are you gonna do?
So we're joined by Siaka as well. So Siaka, you being the pilot of the deck, when he discarded the Quixel Stone, how happy were you?
It wasn't a bad thing because I had a lot of Untamed coming up. So that would have been the main creature control. But I felt that once the Spartasaur was gone, there wasn't going to be much you could do except for the Quixel Stone.
Hmm.
Right.
Now, do you play the Quixel Stone much in this deck?
Not really, but it depends on what's going on in the match. Like, it can actually be a pretty solid creature control.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I say in this instance, when you had the Quixel Stone and being behind two keys to none, I think playing the Quixel Stone would have locked you into a longer game to have a chance.
Just
by
disrupt.
Not playing, he was able to take full advantage of you as far as that goes. But I mean, like, that's hindsight too, like, and whatever. But when we saw it, I was like, I expected you to play it, and I was just wondering what decision you made not to play it, because I guess if you were in a closer game, you don't play the Quixel Stone because, like, you don't want to trap yourself. But at the same time, like, at the position you were at with the way your hand looked with all the pips and, like, the actions that you had in the hand at the time, I thought it would have been okay to slow the game down and try to get your key out, like, while you were... Because your deck has, like, probably 20 creatures in it, right? I didn't count, but, like, he has a lot more...
21.
Yeah, so that's a lot more creatures. So
21 to 18, yeah.
Yeah, so the Quixel Stone would have... been more, I don't know, like, it gave you a tool to try to catch up, I think.
Yeah, well, the Quixel deck is the one with 21.
Right.
Yeah.
Sometimes I've played it to get out of a bad situation with the board, and then it ends up backfiring, like, once I get into the game. So, like, a few turns out, like, it can mess you up. But, yeah. In that state, maybe it would have been a good idea.
But it's funny, right? Because I was reading your deck list the other day. I was like, okay, Quixel Stone only in emergencies was what I told myself. Now, this was an emergency, so maybe... So, you know, maybe I should have broken the glass.
Yeah. We were saying that Quixel Stone deck is... And Quixel in general is probably really great for adaptive because it's just one of those cards that throws everything up in the air. And Jupiter was saying a lot of people are really uncomfortable playing, but I am for sure. And, you know, in adaptive, like, you know your deck, you know how to play with Quixel Stone and your opponent does not. So,
Yeah. That's why Z is playing a double Quixel Stone deck.
With
a Tachyon Pulse, so he can blow up his own Quixel Stone. Have a big turn and play a second Quixel Stone. So if you haven't seen one of the Z's games, Z has a very good Quixel Stone deck. Probably one of the best ones I've seen. You could show me a different one and prove me wrong, but I don't know. Seems pretty close. So, so these guys, Siaka and Brobnar, they both, like we were saying earlier, they do run a show on YouTube called Call of the Week. So you need to check them out. I'm going to go sign up for them once I have a second to do that. And so you can listen to more of these banter, and hopefully we can cross collab more. I'm trying to get that as part of the media package for the league because I don't want to be the only one doing media. So when we can work out things like this and stuff, hopefully for season two, we'll be more put together and be able to do the things that I want to do with the media stuff. But we need more Twitch presence. We need more YouTube presence. YouTube has actually been pretty good. We've been putting up a lot of videos over on the site. So I don't know if any of you guys have caught any. I know some of the players have been researching on the site, so it's kind of cool. But
cool. Yeah, this was fun. Yeah, we can definitely do some more collabs. That'd be fun.
Yep. And so Siaka, with that win, I think that secures you into the top four for your group as well. I'm going to go put you in right now to verify. But I'm pretty sure that win puts you in. I think you were one of those guys. This was Group B.
Yeah, I think that's probably right if I remember. I know, like, for me to get in, I needed to win, and I needed certain people to lose.
you won 2-0, right, Siaka? That was the score?
He did,
yeah. Okay, so I just want to make sure, since you're here. So we got one game left to play, and it's between Justice Blinded and Just a Guy Playing. Siaka, you are currently in fourth place, and nobody is going to take that place from you. The only thing that could happen here is you could move. Oh, wait, I got to refresh this. You're probably in third place because you've played your games and Just hasn't. Oh, Siaka, you actually moved to first place because you're five and one.
Look at you.
So Vincent is locked in and Ugluk is locked in. And it looks like Just a Guy is locked in as well. So it looks like your guys are pretty set. Nothing is going to move around there. As all the play-ups have lost their game, it looks like. So it weeded out pretty good. The cream kind of separated here.
That's a scary lineup of players there. That is a, wow, that's some high-quality players.
Yeah, so this shows how good the league was, right? Mm-hmm. Let me show you guys online. So if you're watching the stream... I gotta take away these white walls I made. Boop, boop, boop. So now I can have them in case I need them. But so here we go on the thing. Let me make this a little bit bigger so you guys can see it. But Siaka first place, 5-1. Kiwi 4-2. Ugluk 4-2. And then Just a Guy Playing has to play. But even if he goes and drops this game to 4-2, he will be in fourth place at least. And if he wins, he goes to 5-1. He'll be up there with Siaka on one of the two. I don't know who. Did you guys play head to head?
No, we never played each other.
Okay, so that's sad. So next season as well, we're going to make sure that everybody plays everybody. That's going to help a lot. But with the season being as big as it was with 10 people per group, we just couldn't do that time-wise. Yeah. It took forever. So
I played against Kiwi and Ugluk.
Yeah, so they're both really good. How did you do in those matchups?
I beat Kiwi. It was a really close game. Unfortunately, it wasn't recorded. It came down on the last turn to two cards in deck and Wild Wormhole. I had to hit Garcia, but he didn't hit it.
Vincent is always in the game. He's very good.
That was an intense match. And then Ugluk beat me 2-0. When I was using his deck, it's like, nothing is happening that he did to me.
Ugluck to me is a Keyforge ninja because he's very quiet. Like he doesn't ever say much and stuff, and he just plays the game and he plays it so well. I met him in Albany and he's so quiet, and but he's so good. Like if you watch him play, he's brilliant. So it's pretty amazing. And so like while you guys are playing and streaming this morning, I'm gonna give the shout out again. But you guys know that we have a tournament coming up, right? An event coming up in December on December 5th, right? And
got it on my calendar.
And guess what? During the stream so far, I don't know if you guys heard, but we've raised the donation now per entrant to $10. So all $10 that you people are paying to get in for the prize pool is being matched by people to go to Borders Without Doctors. Doctors Without Borders. I'm being dyslexic again.
That's way better. Borders Without Doctors sound wrong.
most
dangerous.
Most borders probably don't have doctors. But yeah, so Doctors Without Borders. So, and we're donating it to the COVID section of it. So last time we had 89 people, and we're hoping to see more this time. And from what I've heard, it sounds like we're going to have more, and that would be amazing.
That's awesome. You know, that's really awesome. That's a good thing to do. That's great.
Yeah. So we're trying to stay active and thing. And again, feedback matters, right? Like, so we're doing a lot of feedback requests and stuff because we really want to make this better and better and better and try to just keep moving it forward. So please feel free to always reach out to me, Z, Carl, Muffins, who is Kate, I don't know, depending on how you know her. Any of those people, Steve, but Steve's kind of like the quiet guy too. He's like the admin ninja for our group. So any of those five people, basically we can do things and stuff like that. This is the only season Z will ever play in. He has no bearing on season one stuff, but he has made the commitment to this is it. So if he wins, he wins. If he loses, he loses, but he's not going to play anymore. And there's the I hate Steve from Carl. Carl is definitely the workhorse on the admin portion. He does a lot of the write-ups and he does a lot of the grifts. Like he made the Chota Claws flyer. So Chota Claws is awesome. he's going to be, I guess, making some emotes for the stream once we figure out how to do that with Twitch, because I don't Twitch very much. So I'm still new to that. I've been working on the YouTube stuff. But yeah, like, do you guys have any questions about the league? How have you guys liked it? Siaka, I'll ask you first since you're qualified, and then we'll go to Draskor. But how have you liked the league so far? Have you been, like, what has it done for you as far as positives, negatives, neutrals?
It's been really fun. It's an opportunity to play against some pretty high-level players. I'm learning a lot from these games. I'm learning a lot about my own decks, too. Mm-hmm. And about adaptive. So I've had a great time. I really appreciate all that effort that you and the others put in to help get this league together and sustain a competitive play with these monthly tournaments. Really looking forward to the holiday triad. So yeah, a really positive experience.
Awesome. How about for you, Draskor? What have you gotten from this?
Oh, it's been a lot of fun. You know, I would say that, all my games, I don't know, maybe less this one. All my games have been competitive. I don't know. I feel like I didn't bring my A game today, but all my games have been pretty close. Like even the ones I've won or lost, I felt like were a bit on razor's edge, where each of us really had to think clearly and make the right moves, and we're rewarded for doing so. So that's been fun, and then I've enjoyed doing the podcast a few times with you, Jupiter. That's been a lot of fun.
Well, you're more than welcome to be a regular, man. I love having you. You're fun.
Yeah, it's been fun. Yeah.
And I was just talking actually while you guys were playing. Me and Robner talked a little bit, and it's like I told him, I was like, I kind of do the I sit behind you and let you like drive lately, and like get your ideas, and we talk about cards, and we're really like looking for mid-level players to beginning players to get info from us, right? The idea is that they learn something from what we say. And then Brobnar said, that's exactly how you and Siaka and you or Brobnar and Siaka, blah, 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 I'm confused. but that's kind of how your guys' Call of the Week stream is going too on YouTube. So it's awesome to see people who have been playing the game for as long as we have, like kind of reaching out and helping people. Even though Brobnar, you've been here since pretty early. You've been here since like day one-ish too, haven't you?
I think I started right around when AOA dropped was when I started playing. Okay. So for a while.
I was gonna say, because I know Siaka, I've seen him with back in the days, back when we were doing Keyforge events, right? Like he was in those with us. I believe, I could be wrong because there's been a lot of players and a lot of time, but I believe he's a day one-er. I've seen him around playing a lot. And then Brobnar, I've seen you. I've been playing with you in random pickup games online all this time too. So.
Mm-hmm. But, yep.
It's still funny because like a lot of people are still learning a lot of things and people are now starting to kind of figure out the strategies. I think MM was a very diverse set and it really shook up the landscape of the game. So it's like it's weird for me to say this, but I will say that I think AOA got stronger because of MM. And that's a fringe thought, but like it's the idea is that like I have some AOA decks that like have gotten steam because a lot of the cards that before weren't as good now seem to be really good against things that are happening in MM. So like it's just interesting. But then again, I have some pretty good AOA decks. I've been kind of a connoisseur of finding them, and it's still the worst set to open. I'm by no means saying go buy a box.
yeah,
but, buy 10 boxes if you want that deck.
Yeah. Yeah, AOA is the hardest to get something good out of. Right now, it's like if I was putting them in order, I think I say buy MM first because it's amazing, and then I would say buy Coda, and well, Coda and Worlds Collides are kind of on the same levels. Depends on what you want to do, and then in a very, very far away back AOA, I'd rather pre-order like Dark Tidings in the next set before I bought more AOA.
Yeah, definitely secondary market. If you're gonna buy any AOA, look at the secondary market because you're gonna have way more success.
You can get some good deals too.
Yeah,
unless you can pick up a AOA deck for like box for like $30 or something, like that'd probably be worth it. But
yeah, but you can find Coda for $30.
Maybe.
It's been a while since I feel like you found them that cheap. I mean, you can get good prices, but
you gotta scout. You gotta get there and look. But like right now, I'm buying out stores in my area that are quitting keyboards. Like that's the best. I get good value.
Yeah. But, well, it's good for the value, but hopefully.
When the pandemic lifts up,
we can really take the game to new heights.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the sad story is like an interesting thing, like, as I'll put out for people who are listening still and you guys, is that I had a plan to start a library series of keyboards with kids. And like, basically, I went to the library, talked to the librarian there, and I told her what keyboard was, explained it to her, showed her. They already had a magic club, so they kind of knew what they were getting into. And I had set up to it where I was like, I'll bring everything. I'll bring, you know, extra decks, bulk decks and stuff like that. I'll give them to the kids. They'll have their own decks to play. They'll have a tournament. They can win some stuff if they win. They'll get like some maybe, you know, extra decks or whatever. Or they get to keep the deck that they used for the day kind of thing. And try to generate a library series. And then I was going to do that with I had three different libraries that I was talking to that were going to be in on this. And then I could have started team competitions between the libraries and stuff. And I think that's how we have to grow the game. Because back in the day when I was an early Magic player, like I was an alpha Magic player too. Like I remember like the biggest thing that we had by the time we got to Antiquities and Urza's like Legacy and stuff was we were trying to figure out how do we build the game, how do we make it better kind of thing, like how do we grow it. And we realized that if you're not teaching kids how to play the game, you're killing your long-term goal, right? Because if kids aren't interested in it, then it's going to die out. Like so that's was always been my preaching point for like if you really want to make an impact on the game, the people who are playing the game right now are going to play the game because they love it, right? Like the game is amazing. If you're still playing it, it's because you love this game, because there's really been no OP or organized really going on with it since this COVID thing started. But the players are what are keeping it alive, right? Like we're keeping it alive, and that's cool and stuff, but in order to make it something that I think FFG takes notice of, we have to start to foster ways to get kids to play the game and get more involvement for the future, because like as we grow older and we stop playing because of whatever reason, like the game will just die if there's not a second generation, right? Like, and that's how Magic has done so well, is that they fostered youth play for a long, long time, and now they're at the point where like everybody just wants to play it because it's the easiest game to get into organized, right? So that's my thoughts anyway. Any ideas, any counterpoints to that or talking points?
I think it's good. And there are a lot of things about playing games competitively that can be good lessons for children as well, like being respectful and meeting new people, getting along. It's really great that when you play KeyForge, you can go to an event and you automatically have something to talk about. Like pretty much they could talk about KeyForge all day. So you've already have a common interest. It's kind of like sports, like people can bond talking about that, or politics. If you agree, then you can bond talking about that. as well. And also,
remember the
like,
time
trading?
When you used to be able to talk about that, even if you didn't agree.
Oh, yeah, the temperature's gone up a bit. But yeah, in Keyforge, I haven't seen as much like trading decks, but I actually think that's a pretty good thing too. Like people learn, oh, buying and selling. Also, people, kids can learn like financial skills and saving up, and you know, how to value things. So I think there are a lot of great lessons that you can learn while having fun.
Yeah, and that's part of the sales pitch. When you go to the library, you have to do all that. Like, everything you mentioned is exactly how I pitched it. Like, it's important. But, yeah, so, like, what I'm going to do here, then, is I'm going to jump off of this call and stuff. And, like, thank you guys so much for jumping on with me. And thank you for having me on your stream as well.
Yeah, thanks to you.
But, so, let's get more awareness out there. ABR, I'll see both of you. I'm on Z's team. We're coming.
Stiak and I are actually on the Skippies.
Yeah, we're on the same
team. Together. So,
what, weren't you a captain, Stiak?
Yeah. So we have the Skippy Hogs Brigade.
So you were part of the blind side that Z had when he picked me, huh?
The blind side.
Yeah, because like I know that he didn't mention, because he's the only captain that asked me about what my deck pool was, like what I had for decks, and I explained to him. I was like, well, I have my team vault and I have my vault. And he was just like, okay, good to know. And I heard when he picked me, there was like controversy, because then he mentioned, he goes, well, Jupiter has two deck lists. He has Clint's deck list for UA, like basically Clint is the head of UA, so like he has the library for our team, and then I have my deck list, which is my personal collection plus stuff I'm trying to vend for the team. So I guess that was a big hoopla for a second, because he kind of pulled the wool over people, because we have a huge deck thing. So they basically came to an agreement saying Jupiter is the only one that can use the UA stuff, and they can use Jupiter's stash, but they can't use the UA stash or whatever. And I was just like, see, that's kind of dirty.
Yeah, I think if Clint were in the league, there would be a lot of people interested.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, doesn't Z have like 12,000 decks or something?
Yeah, but Clint is a collector. Like, he has, like, I guess you just have to see his deck list, but he has, like I said, like his top 100
he
decks
really
are probably
decks.
Over 85.
Yeah.
They're all over 85.
Wow.
I think it was fair to limit my what I can do, and I was cool with it. Like, I didn't mind, but the bad thing is that means I don't get to play my decks as much, because he won't let me, because he feels like I'm taking away from somebody else on the team.
So he's making you use Clint's decks.
So I have to use all the decks from our team vault. But to be fair, when I go to Worlds with Clint, like me, Clint, and I think it could be Mike Funai at this point, like I think like because I'm sure Blake is going to be wanting to play with Daniel and his Canadian people. So like kind of changed the, like the scope, because originally it was me, Blake, and Mike, but we were still using Clint's stash, you know. But like now I just want to, like, since me and Clint are the captains of UA for the most part, I want to be on the same team with him. And then I have Mike, who's the guy that I play with the most or talk to the most that's local, so like I trust him. Or if somebody else from UA wants to be on our team, whatever, we'll figure it out if that ever happens. But the idea is, like, me and Clint want to be on the same team, so like I'm gonna have his library for, and we're gonna try to win Worlds, right? Like, and we have a pretty good collection to do it, so we just now have to get our play skill right, but that's a whole nother game. Like,
yeah, hopefully one day,
yeah,
we'll all be there. It'll be fun.
I'm telling you, man, like, that's the saving grace for Keyforgers. It's like they have to come out, like, when this ends and set up Worlds and, like, the big event, and they have to blow it out the water. It has to be so amazing, like, to make it worth the 3-year wait that we're having for it. But, I'm sure they were going to do great. I think it was going to be great when they had it scheduled for Minnesota, right? Like, I think it was going to be pretty amazing.
Sounded cool. Yeah.
I was looking forward to that. I mean, the Mother's Day scheduling was awkward, but other than that.
Yeah.
That was very cool, my mother. I'd be like, so guess what? Priorities.
Yeah. But I imagine, like, the people who have kids, like, oh, that's going to be a hard conversation.
Yeah, I was planning on trying to get back by Sunday night. Like, I was going to take an early flight, but we're going to see. But I don't know if that would have been feasible. I don't know. But, yeah, it was definitely a point of contention. But, again, planning. Planning is hard. But, yeah, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to stay on my stream, because we have another set of important games coming up with Cav and George Kegel in Group A. But I have like a good amount of time before that starts, because they're not starting until 14:30. So that's like 2 hours plus away. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to get on and I'm going to play games with people. I'm going to invite them to be on voice with me if they want to. But I'm going to start my my scaling thing. So every time I win, I get 5 cents. Every time you guys win, I'm going to give 5 cents. And then in the end, we're going to see where I'm at. And that will be my donation towards the Doctors Without Borders. So I'm going to do this for the rest of the month. So I'm going to keep a tab on it. And I'm going to just keep playing games against people. And like whether they know it or not, I'm going to up and down my cost.
Sounds fun.
Neat. Yeah. Cool.
So if you want to make me suffer and thing, you guys could come on and play against me. I don't promise I'm gonna play a fun deck though. I will play a deck off of my collection. I will not be playing off of my collection. That's the one caveat. And you can play whatever you guys want, but I'm not playing the same deck more than once either. That's my caveat as well. So yeah, that's gonna be what that is. But thanks for having me on your guys' show. Thanks for being on my show, and I'll stop talking now because I can talk forever.
Yeah, thanks to you. And you know, if you're interested, definitely check out our show over on YouTube. This is gonna drop tomorrow, and then 2 weeks from tomorrow we'll have the final episode of season 2 dropping. So be sure to check that out.
And now that I have contact with you, we have the top 16 coming.
Ooh.
So maybe you'll have some special show that you can add to your website.
Yeah, definitely. We were thinking around the holidays we want to do kind of some alternate content, so that could be great.
Yeah, so we'll see. We'll talk. Like I said, you guys are definitely in the fam, so like let me know what you guys want out of it, and we'll make it happen. Like anything that other people want to help us push more content, that's great. I am very appreciative of that, and I hope to find more people as we go. So
sounds good.
Yeah, so thanks, and I'm gonna jump out of here now, and I'm gonna go back to my live stream, talk to me there, or I'm gonna go jump in a room so people can come try to take 5 cents from me at a time. so we'll talk to you guys later. Thanks.
All right, thanks.
Cool. All right. Thanks everyone.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, thanks guys. See ya.
Bye. Well, there you have it. Siaka taking it down. Victory in the bag. Another excellent episode of Call of the Week. As I just said, be sure to come back next week for the final episode of season 2. Big thank you once again to Jupiter for letting me record this content, put it up on our YouTube. Thanks once again for watching, and we will see you next time on Call of the Week.